Welcome. We have all members present. Member Rose, Member Sari, Marion, and our new member, second meeting for Ezra Clemens. Welcome again to your first meeting with something on the agenda. Chair's remarks, I think the only thing I've got this month, we had a combined meeting that I think they'll probably reach out to John, the chairs of the Zoning Board of Appeals, the HDRB, and the Planning Board to talk about seeker classification of actions that we'll reach out to Marie Early from the Village Board had shepherded that, and then she'll reach out to CMMR, the Village Attorney, to ask for some interpretations, just to kind of get a sense of how we can process those applications, make sure that we have some consistency and some understanding as we move forward, and that it's a much more streamlined and certainly predictable outcome, so we kind of all understand things. So that's about the only thing I've got. Is anybody, we don't have minutes. We have a brand new secretary, which is great. Thanks and welcome, Mike Ramel. We have been without one for quite some time, which is a little problematic. Thank you for the Village Board for finding one and getting that straightened out. So we'll have to remove approval of minutes for this one. Michael, I'll send you the sets that are ready to go, and then if you could just kind of bless them, and then we'll give them to the village clerk for posting. Reported members, anyone? Nobody? Nope. Okay, correspondence. There was no correspondence. Unfinished business. We'll move out to the matter at hand, which I think probably most of you are here for, which is Butterfield Realty. It's an application for an amended site plan related to the change of use for the existing Leahy Pavilion. Subject property within the Butterfield redevelopment site is known as Tax Map Section 49.5, Block 3, Lot 45. Property is located within the B4A zoning district, as well as the local historic district. So we have finally received a final application. I think back in February, we received a packet that was a set of drawings that was kind of a workshop too, that showed some intention as to what the applicant was asking for as far as the change over on the site. And then on April 7th, the village clerk received a formal application asking for that. So that's the application that we're working on now that was received on April 7th. So we're in receipt of a position statement or legal memorandum of May 11th from the applicant's attorney, Stephen Barshaw from Cy Paget, basically laying out his position and his legal argument with respect to the requests that are being made. Our attorney has reviewed that. It's fairly simple from our perspective. We also have a letter. Part of what the letter addresses in Mr. Barshaw's letter is that the difference of opinion between the two attorneys, and they have spoken, correct? Mm-hmm. So they obviously don't agree, which is often the case. Law is open to interpretation, and then courts ultimately kind of help us continue to decide what the law is. So law is kind of this living, breathing thing. So what we are operating on, Mr. Barshaw's letter kind of intimates that this is the action of the planning board, and the action of, it is not, in fact. What it is we have taken advice of counsel, which is what we are supposed to do. Anybody who's worked with me knows that, I listen to my counsel. Your only choice is really to change counsel, but I don't consider not listening to counsel as an option. So the village attorney has advised us, working with code enforcement, the building inspector, that the request that is being made is a change of use. It was obviously requires an amendment to the site plan that is triggered by the fact that there were a set of assumptions made on the original approvals to, that Leahy was granted the existing parking spaces for the existing use and to remain as existing as a medical facility. It was, it was handled that way. So I have under advisement from the village attorney working with code enforcement, the building inspector who sent advice over to our board just recently on April 22nd, basically stating that, encapsulating, a lot of obviously framework, a lot of legal argument, but basically that the application would trigger whether or not we call it a change of use, it doesn't really matter. It's obviously an amendment to the site plan. And the parking table would need to be updated. So that's pretty much it in a nutshell. Mm-hmm. I should add that, you know, I know there was a report in one of the local papers that the planning board was looking to thwart the project. This was by who I assume is a representative of Mr. Galeros, Mr. Finnegan. He's not in the application. Is he a representative of yours?
Absolutely.
Okay. So that said, you know, it's an attempt to thwart the project, and that the end result could be the complete removal of the uses from the site. I can assure you that while Mr. Barshov was very clear in his memo that we do not have legislative power, obviously the quoted comments to the paper, which seemed to intimate that those comments went out to the seniors in the letter, we don't have legislative authority. We cannot remove uses from a site. The only one that can do that is the village board, which I don't think would attempt to undertake something like that, because they would be open to all sorts of charges with respect to spot zoning. You would have to comply with the comprehensive plan. There's a whole host of issues. So nobody's trying to thwart anything. Back when we met first on September 25th, my question to Mr. Barshov was, we have the code and we have the request, and the code only allows us to reduce by 20%. Now, under the advisement of the village attorney, working with the building inspector and code enforcement, he's saying that we need an updated parking table. So I also spoke with the mayor several times, who met with the applicant, who had, you know, had offered that going back to the existing approvals, which are all in place, there is no action. I can tell you, I'm only one member on this board, I'm only one vote, but I don't think the planning board would have any jurisdiction or have any authority to go look at the underlying approvals if the application were to be withdrawn. And the applicant could proceed immediately, you know, right after we leave this meeting, and go build the whole thing according to the existing approvals. So we are bound by, obviously, the advice of counsel, the interpretation of the code, and that's the way we proceed. I mean, anybody that works with me, and I work with lawyers day in, day out, nights and weekends too, and it's just you follow the advice of your lawyer, because otherwise you have nowhere else to go. I mean, there's really kind of no keeping track of the ends, and there's no kind of explaining your actions. These aren't actions of individuals. These are actions of that we take on behalf of the village, that we take very seriously. And obviously, we don't look to engage in risk for the village. We are not the ultimate. We're not the ones that ultimately bear that risk. It's the village board, and then ultimately all of us as taxpayers. So that's pretty much it in a nutshell. So, like I said, the existing approvals are in place. The mayor has informed me that he met with the applicant and said that is open. I can certainly tell you the planning board would not look to reopen anything. We would have no, I don't believe we would have any jurisdiction to if the application were withdrawn. It is certainly the fastest path. And that's about it. So to continue to process the application, we just need an updated parking table. Obviously a site plan. There was some talk, you know, about the 1,500 square feet and this orphan 1,500 square feet. That again is the work of John working with the building inspector, talking about the use and it not being 11.5 for 11.5. I actually don't fully follow that argument, so the board would have to take that up as our own. But that was my point, Mr. Barshov, in my letter to the applicant, that it isn't the only trigger. And what I was trying to do was try to be helpful, right, as opposed to, and certainly vague, because we don't process applications in emails and on phone calls. They have to be done at meetings in front of the public. As you all have interest, you all should be able to see what's happening. And that's why we do it here in this room at 7 o'clock, the second and fourth Thursday of every month. So, John, what's next?
That's it. If you want to give the applicant or any of the other board members have any comments.
Okay, so you guys, I don't know, this may be my error, that the village clerk forwarded the letter, Mr. Barshov's letter, to me. Did you guys receive it? I didn't notice that it might have only gone to me. Let me make copies of it. I'll be right back. You got one. You have the inside track.
Yeah,
right?
It's on it. I have a good sense
guys,
of what's in it.
I'll make copies. Yeah. Okay, Mom, thank you so much.
Deputies.
We'll just wait for Marie to bring that copy back.
So what about, is there any issue with the traffic flow in the DOT? Will there need to be a notice to them?
Well, I think, the authority of this board is only on the demonstrable impacts of the application. So nothing outside of the application that you can demonstrate an impact can be looked at. We're not allowed to, nor should we. You know, so obviously the condos are a separate plan, the parking for that is a separate plan, you know. We all know the elephant in the room is Springbrook, and there's not enough parking, and this is designed the same way. It's approved. You know, it's approved, it stands, right? I'm one vote on the board, certainly, but it is, I don't believe there's any argument that there is a demonstrated impact of this application to that application. So with respect to parking, we should clear up one error. What was misinformation at the February 25th hearing is that we did not have an application, we had a packet of drawings. One of those packets of drawings was the post office build out at Leahy.
Mm-hmm.
As we went back and forth on the switch of the uses and the site layout and whether or not this was a minor, which obviously the local law allows for the building inspector mm-hmm. to handle minor changes, whether or not this was minor, we talked about the loading dock, right? And so there's our loading area rather because it's on grade, right. it isn't actually an elevated slab. So that loading area, what we were told, and I went back and reviewed the video as well as the notes, is that the Leahy loading area was approved and that the planning board wouldn't really look at that because it was already approved. The building inspector did not have the drawings at the meeting, even though there was 2 weeks prior notice to have the drawings. When we finally got the drawings, 2 weeks later, 3 weeks later probably, those drawings were for an approval for building number 2. So it is, the record does not show any approval for a loading area at Leahy. There is an approval, the September 15, 2015 approval, which is the same date that was given to us that evening as the date of that approval. Once the drawings were sent over, I could not get them. They finally went to the village attorney, who then forwarded them to me. Those drawings were for building number 2. So they're just one point of correction, just so we all understand, is that the loading area at Leahy was not contemplated. It's not in the site plan. And the building inspector did not, in fact, approve a loading dock at Leahy. It was approved at building number 2. But what was interesting that evening was that the postal representative happened to be here. The loading area is a 30-foot deep space. The postal representative that night, who I didn't even know was in the audience, said they're going to bring 60-foot tractor trailers at night. So if the application were to go forward and if we're looking at this, then certainly that's an impact to the traffic flows. A 60-foot tractor trailer coming in, obviously you have to maintain ingress, egress, fire lanes, all of that. So that would be a change. I would not be of the opinion, and I'm only one vote of 5, that it's a minor change. I mean, obviously, a tractor trailer pulling into the middle of a dense site is something that needs to be accounted for, especially, like I said, for its life safety. It's ingress, egress, it's fire lanes, it's all those things that would have to be accounted for.
So
to answer your question about circulation, if it can be demonstrated that there's an impact, I would certainly say, look, the board hasn't taken any of this up. What is believed to be in certain reports and in a little bit in Mr. Barshoff's memo, the board's work is, in fact, not the board's work. The board hasn't taken this up at all. We just got an application on April 7th. Mm-hmm. We had spoken with the mayor, we'd spoken with the village attorney about not really proceeding further without an application because it's a little shaky. It's one thing to workshop something and to talk about something. It's another thing to take somebody's escrow money and to start processing something that isn't a formal application. I don't think that would be wise. We agreed it wasn't wise, and then we got the application on April 7th. So that's where we are.
So what we really need to do is look at what is submitted to us now.
No, I think if the applicant would like to proceed with the application, then we would need a complete packet and an updated parking table. Right, so Leahy was approved, as we all know, with the existing 35 spaces and anticipated to remain as existing. As I understand from John and the building inspector working together, it's that change of use that then triggers the review to comply with parking because it was a pre-existing non-conforming use.
Right? Essentially, yes.
So there you have it. Anybody have any questions or?
No, I have.
No? Nobody?
Huh? Yep.
Right. So I don't know if Mr. Barshaw or the applicant, if you want to make a statement.
Yeah. Paul DeLaro, Butterfield Realty. First of all, we're looking for this, call it revision or whatever you want to call it. We think it's a minor amendment. And the county and the post office have looked at building number 2, where they were originally planned on going into. and it doesn't work for them, okay? For safety reasons and other reasons, and they want to go into Leahy. And that's the only building that would be available for them, okay? So it's important to know that this application, if it's necessary, will go ahead. And this is what we need. We need a senior center looked at Leahy, and the post office will be in Leahy Pavilion.
In Leahy.
Okay. So just to the 60-foot tractor trailer, we have a lease signed with the post office, and it calls for 35-foot trucks maximum.
Oh, okay.
And it restricts the amount of use. I think it's 5 times a day, up to a half an hour a day. Okay, that's it, Monday through Friday.
You don't happen to know the woman? We actually didn't get her name. You don't happen to know who
this
is?
This is with Washington, D.C., okay?
Yeah, but I doubt that they would obviously have local knowledge. I mean,
they signed the lease, okay?
Understood. So, yeah, but real estate may be very different than...
But as far as, you know, this has been taking us, I mean, we didn't even know you had an application process, okay? Every time we come to the planning board, we do it with a letter, all right? We started in January, we were with the building inspector, and then as we're providing information, we're told, yes, you need an application now. That's why we filed an application on the 7th. It wasn't that, you know, nobody ever told us that we had to file an application.
You didn't file an application for the original, or?
No.
Or for any of the other?
Okay. So...
I apologize if there's the information, but that's...
Okay. So anyway, I think at this point, you know, one of the things that we've been told from the beginning for 5 years is we want a senior center and we want a home for the post office. And Butterfield has been identified as that location, okay? And we're trying to accommodate two needs, okay? Two needs that the community has said they have a need for, okay? So right now, Leahy is our building, okay? And we really need to look at that and see how we can accommodate these needs. And I don't want to go much further, but I'm going to have Steve Barshoff talk a little bit and then come back later on, unless you have a question for me.
You're certainly not under any requirement to answer, but I guess it would be helpful to understand what safety or practical concerns there were with modern construction, that you could control the way the building was built and occupied.
The county is here tonight, and they're willing to talk about why they needed to move from Building 2 to Leahy.
I think that's perfectly fine. I don't. It's not really part of an application. I mean, it's a certain, but there's public comment. You know,
to
the public.
I think it's important to know why they would move.
It's certainly interesting because obviously, I mean, as a guy that manages a lot of leases, a lot of square footage, you know, and does capital builds and does all this stuff, you know, way too much. It'd be interesting to know what the challenges are at, because typically your challenges are in accommodating an existing structure like Leahy, not so much in building a new one, but certainly I would be happy to hear what they have
and
to
say. And as far as the post office goes, their loading area had to be on a certain slope, and the existing drive coming in exceeds that slope, and that's why they couldn't go in that building.
So they hadn't done any engineering studies with respect to the original, with the site plan approval?
It didn't happen until it went to Washington. They did their review, and it came back.
So all the engineering study that was done between the EAF and site plan approval never identified that issue?
The post office never wanted to engage until they knew we were real and we had an approval.
Until there was a building?
Yes.
Okay, all right, okay. Fair enough.
Steve Barshoff, counsel for Butterfield Realty.
This is a very clear situation in my view. I don't believe that there is a disagreement among counsel. There is an error that has been made. It has been made by your attorney. It is a clear error. The contents of my letter don't even require a lawyer to review. They are very straightforward. The language of the code is not ambiguous. It was written by the village board in order to give clear direction to the planning board. You were on the village board.
Not written by the village board, written by the village attorney.
It was written by the village board because the village board adopted it.
Okay. I'm not sure how that...
It says where parking is sufficient for existing uses as of the date of this amendment, no additional parking shall be required for said use.
So...
I'm going to finish what I have to say, if you don't mind.
Go ahead. Yeah,
okay? Thank you. There was a determination made by the planning board that the parking was sufficient for Leahy. Medical office use in Leahy. Not Leahy, the medical office use, because it's correlated to uses, an existing use as of the date, nothing to do with Leahy. The medical office use happened to be in Leahy, it doesn't matter, it could have been on, could have been anywhere on the site. That use had a certain amount of parking, and the village board told you that if you found that the parking was sufficient, that was the parking to be required, and it says, no additional parking shall be required for said use, period. It couldn't be clearer than that. This is not subject to interpretation. This is not an interpretation. This is ignoring the plain language of the village's code. That's what you're doing. I don't care whose advice it's under, okay? Now, at the end of the day, what's being done is not a change of use in Leahy. It is the switch of previously approved uses between previously approved buildings with no increase in square footage. That is what is being done. Characterize it any way that you want to say it. That is what is happening. That is what the applicant is proposing. And that is all that the applicant is proposing. You are reopening prior approvals by going back and looking at parking. There is no requirement for an updated parking list to be required, a parking chart, or a parking table, because nothing has changed regarding the uses. If there is any change, we have 1,500 square feet less medical office space than before. But nobody is proposing to reduce the parking. Therefore, there is no basis for you to ask for an updated parking table. You have no jurisdiction to be asking for it. You are looking to reopen this, and the only reason that I can think of that you are trying to reopen this is because there are people that are not in favor of this project or who have wanted or frustrated for a long period of time. We have been through a very long review process. We've been through a review process that began with a community charrette. The community told everyone in Cold Spring what they wanted. The developer is building what they want. We've been through the Historic District Review Board to get a certificate of appropriateness. We've been through a planning board process that went on for months and months and months. We were heard by the village board. We had a rezoning. And now you're telling me that, and the planning, I would like the county to tell you what the impact is on them. Now you're telling me that because we want to flip interior locations of uses, that this is akin to a whole new application that we have to go into about parking and so forth. It is absolutely ludicrous. And I'd like the county to speak to what the harm is going to be to their operations and their programs, please. Who is here from the county?
My name is Pat Sheehy. I'm the director of the Office for Senior Resources, and it's my job to advocate for the seniors. And it's interesting that Mr. Galara mentions that in the original project, at the beginning of the opening of it, that the town and the planning board knew that they wanted to have a senior center there. And it's kind of interesting today, because in trying to understand what this meeting tonight was about, I went online just to see what's the real function of a planning board. And I see that one of the functions also is to provide for community services. And certainly, here in this side of the county, there's no dispute that the lack of an adequate senior center is a real community need. So I started as director 4 years ago, just as the project was starting. And I remember I started on March 15th, and I think on March 16th, Cold Spring had a St. Patrick's Day party. I went there, and Bill Eustace, I'm sure many of you know him, he's passed away since, the first thing he said to me is, we've got to get this senior center done. He said, Butterfield is the place to do it, and he said, I don't believe I'm going to live to see it. Unfortunately, he didn't live to see it. So, you know, I come here tonight a little bit outraged that I'm feeling that this project is being held up for what I can't see as a substantial change. I'm not on the planning board, but you know, I think of it almost like a college campus, you know, and if I'm gonna move the history department from building number one to building number two, and I'm gonna move the science building from building, you know, and just swap them. I feel like that's kind of what we're doing here. And you know, I see a lot of the seniors that have traveled back and forth from this side of the county to the other side of the county, dealing with all this. As a director of the Office for the Aging, we're trying to plan. Our budget time is coming up. We're all set to go. We thought maybe we'd be in at the end of this summer. Now I'm hearing probably not going to be able to start till November or later. And if they start having to turn in new plans and that, I just see more and more delay. And I think it's unfair to your community to have these kinds of delays. It certainly puts us in a very bad position, having to figure out how we can serve the seniors that are here. You know, the center that we have right now is woefully inadequate. We only are able to feed about 40 people a day. 35% of this population in Phillipstown and within the next 10 years is going to be seniors. And next year we expect it to be approximately 26% of your population. So the need is there, the access is there, you know, and to hold this project up is just disappointing.
That's it? Are you done?
Yes.
Okay. So I have a question for you, though. So what you were supposed to, what we thought we were going to hear was that you had a challenge with building number one or building number two, that there was life safety issues. There was, I don't know what, right? That there was some sort of physical constraint with the buildings that, because obviously you, there's been an approval in place for over a year.
Mm-hmm.
Buildings could have been built. We had a mild winter. You know, you know, I mean, in building number one or building number two, you could be in a building. You could be under roof. I built one. You know what I mean? So, I mean, it's, so the question that what would be most interesting, I think, to this board, since we are obviously bound by the code, mm-hmm. And I hear you. You're saying, you know, what is this? Well, what it is that we're bound by the code, right? We look at the code. If there's any question, we go to the village attorney. The village attorney advises us. The village attorney says, update the parking table. I understand that people don't like the answer. The fastest path are the approvals that are already in place, which was originally building number one. When the planning board started to review it and when they did the site plan approvals, it was building number two,
mm-hmm.
Which is a beautiful new building, which is under roof. The windows are in. You know, the it obviously needs to be sited, but that's the fastest path. So we understand there are some sort of challenges to operating a senior center in building number one or building number two.
And I can answer that. When the original plans were done in that, a lot of that work was done by our engineering department and Mr. Glaro on that. And towards
the county's engineering department?
Well, I think
was doing
well, they were working with the developer at that point in time,
okay.
to design the senior center, huh? Within the building. And then towards the end of last summer, the final plans went out and they were sent to me and I took a look at them. And the access for the bus to deliver the seniors to the center became an issue because of, you know, and I'm not an engineer and I wasn't involved in the traffic pattern of the development, but what would happen was the bus could not pull up to the front door of the senior center.
Is this building one or building number two?
Building number two.
Building number two.
So what they would have to do is either park at the end of the road and then the seniors would have had to get off the bus and walk to the entry. And most of the seniors who travel on the bus that we pick up are frail elderly. They have walkers, they have canes, they have breathing issues. So for them to have to walk, I think, what was it, about 30 feet? Was it more than 30 feet?
Well, it was about 70 feet.
70 feet from the end. That would be a huge challenge. So then we looked, and they said they can access through the lower level of the building, pull right up front there, and come in. But the problem there with the design of the building was a long hallway, and they'd have to take the elevator up, and there was no restroom for them. And, you know, the seniors were on the bus for maybe 25 to 45 minutes. And unfortunately, when they get there, the first thing they have to do is use the restroom.
I hear you.
And so for some of them to get on and off the bus itself is a huge challenge, and they need to have a place to sit and rest. So having access on a level ground is really the best place for them to have it, and you know.
Which was always a requirement, if I were to guess, right? It would always be understood. I understand the post office may not be available, may not have engaged, but you had full access to the county. So are we saying that with all the money you spent on engineering, I mean, was it $250,000 to B&L, and to get to an approved site plan, they missed this too?
Well, I think that.
It was a county review.
And let me tell you, I work with engineers all the time. I've had errors and omissions claims. It happens all the time. I'm not suggesting it doesn't happen. You know, the mechanical, the MEP package is always the biggest problem on a job. But nevertheless, that's a pretty big miss. I mean, you have a known requirement. So neither of those could be accommodated in building number one and building number two. And I ask only because it's the fastest path. I don't, you know, there's a.
Building number one is not in the equation right now. Okay, it's building number two related. Okay, we built number two thinking they would go into that building. They had issues with that, and we moved them to later.
That were not uncovered under the engineering study or the site plan review,
right.
And then eventually the board approved a site plan for that year.
That's when it was uncovered.
Okay.
Because I think a lot of people thought, you know, the seniors will get off the bus and they'll walk 70 feet, you know?
Right. No, it's not their fault. It's basically, you pay professionals to do this. You pay professionals to, you know, to plan. Right? They're planners, right? That's, you know, that's why it's a big piece of their job. It's a question. It's a fair question. Frankly, it's a reason why they carry errors and omissions insurance.
And I
just
want to say.
Because they make them and they cost people money.
I want to say that we've had the opportunity to look at the plans for the Leahy building, and it just is a really great site to have the senior center in. And, you know, the numbers aren't going to change. So, you know, I hear you talking about the parking. I don't see how it's going to impact the parking. So, you know, we would really urge you to help us move forward and get this for your community as well as for all the seniors who sit here in the audience tonight.
And I think that's the goal. I mean, look, that's the, you know, when I was on the village board, that's the goal. You do what you think the majority wants, not what you personally want or what you don't want. People want to talk about what people personally favor or don't favor. And a lot of times it's people that also have their own personal favorites as well. But the reality of it is that we're bound by the code and we take an oath of office and we're supposed to do what we're supposed to do. And right now, and it was my question to Mr. Barshaw on February 25th, is what would you advise me to do? I mean,
follow the code, and I'll read you the section one more time.
I appreciate that, but while you're Mr. While you're Mr. Galera's attorney, you're not our attorney, right? Our attorney has a different opinion. What you say is a glaring error.
But you're telling me that you're going to apply the code, and I'm agreeing with you.
Okay.
Apply the code. The code is so
right,
clear. How could you possibly debate this?
I don't think you want to get into this tonight, right?
At the end of the day, the bottom line is this. You have the same square footages flipping between buildings. You want to go back and re-look at the parking that the prior planning board established. Let's just be honest about what you want to do. It's not all a whole bunch of fancy words. You want to turn around and you want to look at the parking that was already approved and you want to ramp it
Mr.
up.
Mr. Barshaw, you do not get to assign intent.
Okay.
You can interpret our code. You do not
There's
tell
no
us what we intend to do.
There's no reason to do it. You're going to reduce the parking?
I'm not telling you what my intent is. Normally you tell me
There's no reason to go into this if you have no purpose in mind that has any productive value. Then what are you doing to the seniors?
I believe you understand the position of our attorney. You believe he is very wrong. I accept.
I believe
but that
he
doesn't
said
change.
To me that this is your decision. Those were
is
his
that true?
Words. That was exactly
in
his
the end,
words.
It's ultimately the planning
That's
board's
right.
decision.
In the
as
end,
far
it's
as
the
yes,
planning board.
Yes, and so I'm saying here we are at the end. You've got a square issue right in front of you. Are you going to go and have a public hearing? Why don't you turn around and just be straight with all of the people in this room, all of the seniors out of here?
I was straight, Mr. Barshaw. What I said is I will not go against the advice of the village attorney.
Your village attorney advised you that you make this decision. That's what his advice, what he said to me, and he's just reiterated it. So make the decision. You're going to turn around and ignore this provision of the code, or you're not?
I have a memorandum.
Just to clarify, you know, he points to a couple of sentences in the code, but the sentences he's relying on assume a couple of things. They assume that the parking was approved as per the parking table in section 18A, or that the waiver was granted. Now, for the Leahy Pavilion, that never happened. They just assigned the 35 spaces. And it wasn't due to the code calculations, it was based upon an historical use.
That's incorrect. I've been with this application for 4 years, that's incorrect. We have calculations which is less than 35. We arbitrarily said, okay, it's gonna be 35, even though the actual number is 30. and we could prove that the number is actually 30 for the Leahy Pavilion. Just to go on the record.
Okay, but when we asked you
11,500 square feet at 150 square feet per space?
The code says five per doctor's office, per physician's office.
Right,
five physician's offices times five.
Home occupation.
That section of the code only applies in residential.
It's just a residential zone.
This is
before, it's a business zone.
It's a business.
It was always a business zone. It was
before
A.
The way that this was done was very simple.
And you're right. I wish that code did apply, and I've asked the code update committee. It's silly that it's only residential.
It's 1 per 300.
But it doesn't.
On the second floor, it's 1 per 300.
Right, the Leahy's one story.
Leahy's one story.
This was done on the basis of the historic usage, just the way it says in the code. This is just the way it was done. And yes, 35 spaces were assigned because it was determined that the historic parking that was provided was sufficient.
Right, okay, let's stay on that point for a minute.
So the language says where parking is sufficient for existing uses as of the date of this amendment, no additional parking shall be required for said use, beginning, middle, and end.
All right, let's stay on that point for a minute. So when we asked you as to how that was determined, in the meeting on the February 25th, you said lots of people said it was sufficient. And we said, can we get something a little more specific? What we got from the applicant was a October 2011 email.
The planning
that said,
board
I'm sorry, when I stop talking, I'll be finished. So on October 18th, 2011, we got a two-sentence email from Mark Webster that said, and this was to document that the parking was sufficient. It said, I have never heard a complaint about the parking, period. So, comma, I am assuming that it is adequate. That's what was provided for this board.
You do not have the jurisdiction to go back and decide the basis upon which they made their decision. They made a decision. It is the statute of limitations. The challenge it has passed. This board has no power to look behind it.
Nobody.
You don't get to look at the evidence as to what gave rise to it. They made a determination that there was sufficient parking, period.
Right.
And it doesn't matter how they made it.
You're conflating two statements I made together.
I'm not
right?
conflating
but
anything.
If you finish it, if you might understand. So I said we won't reopen, right? We're not going to reopen if the application is withdrawn.
When you look back at why they did what they did, you're reopening.
There is an application. What I said about not reopening was if the application is withdrawn. This board has no jurisdiction to look at anything, and I agree. Too much time has passed to look at it. Regardless of what problems, a letter from the CFO saying, basically committing nothing.
It doesn't matter.
Right?
The decision was made that the existing parking was sufficient. Therefore, 35 spaces were assigned. Therefore, that's what applies to this use, whether it's in Leahy, whether it's in building two, whether it's in building one, whether it's in the park, wherever it is. That is it.
I don't think anybody challenges that.
Then we are done.
No, but the
because there is nothing to review in terms of the parking. We are finished.
No, the problem is you've moved a medical use that was supposed to be approved as a medical use with 35 spaces, Leahy Pavilion. You've now moved that to another building.
Yes, so
it
what?
It opens up, so now
no,
you have new uses
nothing.
Going into the Leahy Pavilion,
not.
And there's different there calculations
is no non-conforming,
when you apply
there is
the
no
zone.
Grandfather, there is nothing. There was a
well,
use
if you're basing
that was
parking on historical use, if that's not grandfathering,
it's no, it's not grandfathering. Is. This is a standard in the code. It is not a grandfather. There's nothing substandard about it. You grandfather something when you don't meet the requirements. And we met the requirements because the requirements are stated right in the code.
You didn't?
By definition, you meet the requirement because the planning board said what the requirement was. And that's it. And there's no debate about this. And there is no grandfather of nothing. And that's why I'm agitated, because this is crystal clear. And we've got a group of people here that have gone through a development process for a hell of a long period of time, and we're cocking around here with stuff that means nothing. The parking was stated, it was ruled on, the planning board made its decision, and that is it.
And now you're changing the application.
We are not changing anything other than moving approved uses into another building which was already approved. There's no change in use, there's no change in square footage that increases anything. It stays the same. And there's nothing in this code anywhere that says you can't move uses around or that there's some prohibition against doing so. That is you fabricating it, as I said in this letter. Yes, it is. There is no language in there. If the standard is that you get to reopen parking because you took a use that was approved in one building and move it to another and you don't change the use, then yes, you are fabricating a provision because there is nothing in the village's zoning code that allows you to do that.
Mr. Barsha, I accept that this narrative that focus on me is what you want to focus on, but that's really not helping.
I get my client an approval from this board for the simplest, most benign change imaginable. This does nothing to hurt anybody. Is there anybody in this room who lives nearby who's going to be hurt by this?
No.
Anybody?
Okay.
No.
Is there
nobody?
Anybody who wants to speak to this as to whether it's going to be good for them?
Yeah.
Okay, let's hear.
This isn't a public hearing.
Yeah. Well, John, so I'd like to clear up one thing. Mr. Barsha seems to believe that he heard from you that you're working under my direction, not the other way around. I assume what you told him was that ultimately it's the planning board's decision. We need to clear that up immediately.
Correct.
Because this is, you know, it's a narrative that's been out in the press, certainly in one paper, not the one that, you know, prints actual reporting. But that's a narrative that has been consistent, right? I mean, you know, we are all bound by, we all have a job to do, right? And there's code that we're bound by. You obviously received, you know, Mr. Barshaw's email. You did not want to change your position. Right, we discussed that again today before we went in. I said, you know, is this your final answer? Because we're going to the meeting. And that's the answer. That's the interpretation of the code.
I would suggest that the planning board members, I mean, they probably need some time to look at Mr. Barshaw's letter. They can compare it to my memo. And, you know, I'd be happy to meet with them and discuss it. I mean.
For advice and
advice of counsel session.
This is all pretty interwoven. To talk, you know, for us to get into interpreting the interactions of sections of the code, right? Especially when somebody who's admitted to the bar doing a land use practice has already come up with an interpretation. What do I add to that, right? I'm not an attorney, right? What do any of us add to that? We have advice of the village attorney on how to proceed. Does anybody want to talk to the attorney and try to?
I'm not going to tell the attorney what the law is.
But we are going to have a meeting, obviously, but ultimately, The risk is clear, right? The applicant has taken the applicant's attorney has taken a position on their behalf. Obviously, the risk is ultimately absorbed by the village board, and you know who manages that risk, and then all of us share that the ultimate cost of that risk as taxpayers. But this board is not authorized, based on what the village attorney is telling us, we're not authorized to do it. Correct?
Correct.
Yeah.
All right, so that's where we are. So.
I do have a question, just for, this is our meeting, so it's my time to talk a little.
Proceed.
We've got two buildings, and the unit, the uses are switching one to here, one to there.
Right.
And that involves entries and egress and buses coming in and trucks going out.
Right.
So all we're talking about here is parking, but my concern is the safety of the pedestrians. So ultimately, I'm very concerned about the traffic flow and how it's going to change with this flip-flop. So is that not on the table?
No, I mean, that would be another site plan issue. I think we're rebutting heads with the applicant as far as whether the parking changes, but I think there could be other impacts due to the switch, whether it's internal circulation, loading zones, parking, handicap parking, those are all site plan issues.
I'm very concerned about the safety of the pedestrians.
That would be a demonstrated
impact,
right? Right.
Just focusing on the changes, though. Just
The last planning board put a lot of time into looking at how people would come and go to each of these two buildings.
And apparently, that didn't go well.
Now the uses of these two buildings are changing on the site, right. So all of a sudden how all the people come and go to each building is different. So I feel like I need to see that every pedestrian and every car that enters that site is safe. And it's because I do support the senior center very much. You're my neighbors, and I don't want any traffic problems.
There's no objection from the applicant, and never has been, to to discussing site circulation, loading. Matter of fact, we had these discussions with the building inspector.
Right.
Whether, I thought, to be quite honest with you, the building inspector can speak for himself if he's here, but as far as I knew, all of those issues were resolved. I don't know if there were formal approvals that were issued. Maybe there were, maybe there weren't, but I can tell you one thing.
There were formal approvals for Building 2.
Right, yes. Okay, but I'm telling you, I thought that those issues were already done and that he looked at them. But let's even assume that they weren't. So fine. So we'll turn around and take a look at that. There's no problems with that. And I agree with that.
That's all I'm asking.
Fair enough. And all I'm asking is, let's not open up the door of the number of parking spaces that's required. You want to look at site circulation? Absolutely. You'll get a very warm reception from this very agitated lawyer, okay?
But just the county engineer is here because he looked at circulation. I think you'd like to talk to that a little bit, right?
We do.
Is that on the agenda?
Well, we'll go into comment. Does the board have any other questions for the applicant before we get into comment? Nobody? John? Very good. Public comment.
All right.
Your name, please.
My name is Commissioner Penna.
Come over here. Come on down this end.
Sure.
Thank you.
Actually, this is a good spot because this was one of the first layouts that we had an opportunity to take a look at in last summer. We were mostly focused on this area. There were some complications when we did some studies, as Director Sheehy mentioned. The elevator was an issue. Emergency egress for seniors was an issue. We were getting into some complications.
Why is the elevator? What's the? Can you?
Well, because seniors getting in and out of an elevator is not favorable if you don't have to have it. It wasn't impossible, and we weren't finding it that it was not doable. But we did, when we had an opportunity to look at the circulation and how the seniors would be dropped off, because the entrance to this building is here, and there was no way to have a bus circulate through there and then make a U-turn in that location. We found it more favorable to circulate the bus through, to drop them off directly in the front, provide the shortest walking distance for the seniors, and to access the building safely because it's accurate.
And can you help us understand, obviously the applicant paid a lot of money, you know, a lot of folks made a significant amount of money discussing all this and planning for all this.
But that wasn't his responsibility to plan for our seniors.
Well, your tenancy was not only known, it was greatly anticipated, right? I mean, that's a lot of the people, we support this project because it created those two homes, a home for the post office, which is now in a trailer, and a senior center that continues to languish. So you were always known and you were always available. So the question is, what do you have any idea how this was missed? Or,
well, let me,
and it may not be a fair question.
The main reason is this, is that nobody believed this project would ever be approved. So the post office just said, come to us when you're approved, and the county said, come to us when you're approved.
So the engineering didn't even anticipate a bus coming and going?
We didn't know we were going to get a commitment from
anybody. Why should we? Because you got a site plan approval.
No, it was not a site plan approval for something specific. It could have been in a lot of different buildings, right? It could have been in building 1, 2, or Layton.
The simple fact is that regardless of how we got here today, and I don't understand the point of trying to question how it was that something was missed about the technical design of the senior center. The fact of the matter is...
But that's what you're presenting to us as your challenge.
No, it's not. I'm not presenting anything as our challenge. We're just simply looking to flip approved uses between approved buildings.
Because you have a challenge for use.
Doesn't matter what the reasons are. That's the reason that we are here.
It
doesn't make any difference.
Okay.
You have a goal, a legitimate goal of assuring circulation and pedestrian safety.
Yes, absolutely.
Fine. That's it. There is nothing to be gained from, or no basis for, no jurisdiction to inquire as to why they made a mistake in their engineering. Now, all that I want to be able
but
to
so
say,
can I ask why you want them to explain this to us then?
What I want them to explain to you is that these projects are ready to go. They've done their engineering, they have their planning, they're ready to go, and the longer that this board takes in issuing an approval, and by the way, it takes us a week at the most to sit down and work through site circulation issues, which I believe that the building inspector has already looked at. We should be on the cusp of an approval. That's what we should be on the cusp on, not a process that is going to go on. And the reason that they're here is to tell you, are you ready to go to rock and roll? Are your plans
yes,
done?
In fact, we've gone through a lengthy RFP process to select the architectural firm to convert our schematic that we had worked on with all of the stakeholders that are involved in this project, and it's ready to be approved. So we were moving forward. We're on the launch pad right now. But
you did an RFP?
Yes, we did. What I did want to do is I did want to reassure the board that from a function or from a scope or our project, the Putnam County project for the senior center, no change in scope, scale, function, or use has occurred. It really was just a move from this building to this building, and it was at our request because we felt it was a safer operation for our seniors when we had a closer look or an opportunity to sit down with the developer, and we made the request because we felt it would better serve the seniors. It's a priority project, and as correctly stated, we are at the launch pad and ready to pursue this project wholeheartedly.
And there's a concern that the longer that this goes on and the lead times that are necessary, we're going to start to roll into winter, and we're going to start to lose yet more time.
Yeah.
Okay, we're already in May.
Thank you. If there were any other technical questions.
I have a question.
Sure.
You said that the primary reason for moving from Building 2 to Leahy is
this one here,
the transportation of the seniors?
Here, this allowed us to provide the senior center all at one grade. This required an elevator and other movements that aren't favorable for seniors. When we had an opportunity to review the site late in the game, because we wanted to know that the developer was fully capable of providing this effort, we asked him, and he did pursue it on our request to get us into the Leahy Pavilion. And so that really what came from us.
Well, did you look at putting the senior center on the first floor of Building 2?
It wasn't available.
It is still available, isn't it? You have a tenant?
So,
but the tenant can move to the second floor?
There's already a second and third floor full.
Now the bus, I can understand it's easier for the bus to drive through.
Right, because you can drive through and drop off here.
But couldn't the bus also pull up and just back in?
Well, see, here it's not possible because now you have a essential dead end through there, so it was more favorable for us to have positive drop-off and then continued motion. For
but the bus couldn't pull up and just back in, so the seniors...
The backing in was what we were concerned about.
I don't think the applicant has any interest in...
Broken U-turn for our bus drivers wasn't favorable, particularly after you've dropped off seniors.
Okay, so the reasons that you want to move, or you favor moving, one is the bus delivery.
The bus operations and drop-offs, the at-grade nature of the building allows improved circulation for ADA and senior activities. It allows everybody to use the site on the same grade. So that was very favorable for us. And when we looked at that, that's what we thought would be an improvement to the overall service.
Could you indulge me for just 1 second? The 35-foot maximum on the post office trucks, where would those be, and where would those affect the drop-off, or would those affect the drop-off for the seniors?
We don't have truck operations with it.
Yeah, no, but I could show them where.
Yeah. It's right here.
The drop-off is right here. I mean, the loading area is down here. The entrance for the seniors is on this side.
Okay. Right. And the truck and the bus is going to go around, up, around and out on...
The bus can come this way or it can come this way.
Unless there's a truck there, right?
No, the truck is inset.
It is inset?
Yes, it's right behind, actually, the dumpsters, the face of the dumpsters.
Okay, mm-hmm. Thank you.
That's the only way the bus could go, because the road up on top is one way in the opposing direction. It would have to go between the two buildings. It couldn't go up and...
No,
by
no,
4, 5, 6.
Right. It could come in that way right now.
Right.
Can I just add one thing too? When we were looking at all that too, one of the things that came to mind also is that at a senior center,
frequently we need emergency services coming in too, like ambulances and that. So this location was much better for that as well, too.
Yeah.
Could just, what you were talking about.
And again, those were our criteria issues that we brought to the developer and tried to resolve them at our first or very early meetings, but we didn't get that until he had commitments that we could actually move forward with this project.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Could you just state your name for the...
My name is Carl Albano. I'm a Putnam County legislator. I speak for myself, but I believe I represent the views of many of the legislators, the majority. We very much support this project. When we see 3,000 or 4,000 seniors in this area, we know this is absolutely needed. I look at this site plan and I say, basically what we're looking at is an improved site plan. There's no change of capacity or any kind of traffic flow. You have a group of buildings here. When we looked at this, we had to make a determination to say what's the best way to have this project go down. And you know, you mentioned many times, what's the fastest path? The fastest path is not always the best path. And that's why people are here tonight, because they see a better path, a way that this could work more correctly. To delay this is just crazy, because I remember last year listening to the secret review. It was done, it was complete, and all of a sudden, a lot of time was spent on that, and your special counsel said it was done correctly. But again, weeks go by, time goes by. These things are time sensitive. If you get into the winter season, we'll lose a year. The bottom line is, all I can say is, please don't go the fastest path, go the best path. Today they can do what they have approved, but there's a better way, and that's why they're here. So make it simple. It's not going to recreate anything. It's going to make it work, and the seniors are going to have what they want in the near future. Don't delay this. It's really a shame to do that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Vinny Tamagna, a prior legislator, and also worked for the planning department. Sandra Fusco is here as well. She's deputy commissioner of planning. I want to just start out by saying, when we started this a long time ago, we had the leadership and everybody wanted this. The town supervisor wanted it, the mayor wanted it. You know, it was about saving the post office and creating a place for our seniors, our senior community. And Barbara Scucciamara wanted me to just kind of reiterate this. She couldn't be here tonight, but that we finally have a willing county. You have Commissioner Pena, you have Deputy Commissioner Planning, prior chairman of the legislature, a county executive that's willing. When I started this project, we had a county executive that wasn't so willing, and we had a legislature that was completely split. We are at a point now in the county where we are ready to go. And I can't tell you how many seniors I promised when I was a legislator, and they're not with us anymore. And somehow we need to put this on the fast track for the community. I also want to add that I have an adjacent property. I live at 45 Paulding Avenue. Construction's going on. The piles of bricks are in my backyard. That's the impact that I have. There is otherwise no impact over this site, and by delaying it, there's more of an impact than if you just let this thing go through. I was with the county executive, I was with Commissioner Pena, when we talked about the switch. And maybe it wasn't presented, perfect. There was so much discussion. But I think a line of seniors waiting to get on an elevator when a busload is dropped off is not conducive. And maybe it was our fault in the beginning when the county said, yeah, that's a good building. But realizing it, we took a corrective action. We also know that seniors do have to, as they say, go to the bathroom. All of that stuff came into play all of a sudden. In public transportation, and I'm transportation manager for Putnam County, you never back up a bus. A public bus should never be going in reverse. That was a big issue here when we looked at it. And we're saving the taxpayers money, because the one thing that didn't come out yet, and I know we discussed it, when this was on the second floor, we were going to have to get involved in re-engineering the capacity loads because of the weight of the kitchen equipment. And when we moved over to the other facility, and all of a sudden everything is on grade, those costs all went away. We're in the process now, and I could only, you know, plead with you all to apply common sense. I know lawyers, you know, sometimes don't see eye to eye, and there's always different opinions. But leadership is not, and I was on a planning board before I was a legislator, leadership comes from the community boards that are there. It's you people that ultimately make the decision. And if you're just taking, you know, I looked at the plan today again, and the parking lot is the same. If the people who were going to go from the Leahy Pavilion to a parking spot and the people that were going to go from the senior center to a parking spot, those same parking spots are still there. And so there's really no change. It was two willing tenants. And probably for the hospital, it's better as well because they don't have to go into an old building in a renovation. They're in a sterile environment. Anyway, as an adjacent property owner, I'm for it. I want to thank the county for their full support. You've never been here before, and the leadership of this town of Phillipstown has wanted this in the past. Please do whatever you need to think of the seniors and put them first.
Kathleen Foley, I'm a resident and taxpayer in Cold Spring. I am awestruck sitting here this evening because the kinds of questions that are being raised tonight, traffic flow, bathrooms, parking, pedestrian safety, all of this, these issues all should have, and I think that in good faith, taxpayers in this village believed that these issues were being thoughtfully addressed under SEAKER, and that they were being thoughtfully and professionally addressed under the site plan review. I'm astonished to hear professionals stand in this room and say that you didn't realize what your needs were for these buildings that we have been talking about for years. I'm astonished. And it makes me call into question the integrity of the SEAKER process. It makes me call into question the integrity of the site plan process. It makes me call into question the integrity of the professionals that were associated every step of that process. It makes me call into question their capacity. It makes me call into question their professional licenses. I am infuriated this evening. And I'm speaking as a private citizen, I am furious.
Thank you.
You ought to be asking the same question, ladies.
I'm sorry, if I could just make one more comment.
Yeah,
I can. The site works for
all. I am not against the seniors. I am not against the seniors.
Okay, let's not get excited.
No. Excuse me, Mr. Albano. I am not against the seniors. Never have been. Give them a center. Give them a center that provides pedestrian safety, that gives them reasonable transportation, that doesn't shift the impacts of your Mr. Galera's private development onto the taxpayers of this community. We will bear the burden of the infrastructure mistakes. We will bear the burden of the public safety mistakes. We will bear the burden of the pedestrian mistakes. I want my seniors, who are my neighbors and my friends, who I love, who have given us in great good heart this community that we all cherish. I want them safe on the street. I want them to have the facilities they deserve, and I'm tired of the bait and switch. All of it. The county, this development, all of it.
Thank you. What I just wanted to say is these issues have all been addressed.
I'm sorry, it's going to be difficult to hear with the crosstalk. There's also a reporter as well as a secretary trying to take notes.
I just feel deeply about this. These issues have all been addressed. The site works the way it is. You recognize that. No one has questions with that.
Sir? Yes.
Well,
I've been on the planning board since last year,
okay. And
I have not gone over this circulation and the safety of this new space.
Yeah, but I would just point
yeah,
out.
I don't want to go into that.
I would just point out that this is an approved site, which goes to say that those issues have been addressed. That's all I'm pointing out.
What's going on here and what's going on there.
Can I just finish talking? I respect
it changes.
That. All I'm pointing out is we know the way it is now has been addressed. There's no question there. You have a group of people that have looked at it and said they can make it even better and it'll work a little bit better. That's all I'm really hearing here. We're not adding more spaces, we're not adding more square footage, we're not increasing the capacity. We're saying we've identified, we've identified a way to make it even better than what it is. You're correct. You have something now, it can go right ahead now and everybody can go home. but there is a way to make it even better. That's what's in front of us now, and to delay that would be a shame, because we're not gonna redo the whole site.
Thank you. John, you're...
Thank you. My name is John Cronin. I live at 64 Paulding Avenue. I've been a resident of Phillipstown since 1981, and I've been living in Cold Spring for 13 years. 13 years, actually, my involvement in this property is full of ironies. When we moved to Paulding Avenue, the big debate for my wife and I was the lack of value of the property across the street from us. That we were moving across the street from an abandoned property. And I said to my wife, don't worry, the village is not gonna let it stay like this for very long. And the second irony, of course, is that in that intervening time, I've actually become a senior. So it's kind of alarming that I am now also an advocate for a senior center, which I never anticipated being when I moved to Paulding Avenue. But I also rise here to call into question nobody's integrity. I've been involved in government, local government. I worked for a state legislator. I worked for a congressman. I was the vice president of a school board. I've sat in on advices from opposing counsel many times. And sometimes when I worked for Mr. Hinchey, he took my advice over counsel because there was no legal ramifications if he did. But reasonable people can disagree reasonably. And I think for me, the important issue is there any harm in this change? And let me just add, I'm annoyed at the village, I'm annoyed at you, I'm annoyed at everybody involved that this wasn't thought of. County, I'm annoyed at you, all right? So, but that's all behind me already, because now what we've got is what we've got. And you'll also all recall that my proposal, the one only man standing for this site, was that all the buildings be knocked down, Mr. Galaro be paid a fair price for his property, we have a park, and the village taxpayers take the burden of that purchase. I'm the only one who thinks that that's a good idea. I've lost that idea, all right? Now we've got...
No vote for an outdoor senior center?
What's that?
No vote for an outdoor senior center? I don't think it's...
Whatever. Whatever they want. Whatever they want. But now I'm a senior, so I wasn't a senior when I had that idea. So what's in front of us now, to me, is whether or not there's any harm in this proposal. I see the opinions of opposing counsel. I can see it from both their points of view. I understand the letter of the code. I've questioned the attorney on it. I've questioned Paul on it. Paul will let you know. I irritate the hell out of him every time I have a question about this property, and he's made some changes to make my life easier on Paulding Avenue. But I think that the village board can reasonably and with integrity make the decision that there's no harm, no foul here, that there isn't going to be an impact.
The village board?
I'm sorry, the planning board. I take that back. The planning board. No, it's an important distinction. Yeah. No, I meant you, the planning board. That there's no harm, no foul here.
The village board can, by the way.
Well, don't get me involved in that. That's a discussion for others. There's no harm, no foul here. That the planning board can make a decision to process this application and move it along. And the benefits on the other side of that are enormous. The negatives on denying it are big. The benefits of approving it are large. As a property owner, there is no negative impact for me on any of these changes that have been proposed. I just want to be clear on that for the record. I have a vested interest in this more than a lot of people in the village do because of what I have to look at, what I have to live with. But for the good of the seniors and for the good of the community, I think these are changes worth making. And I think that you can decide on this application and have made a decision with integrity. I don't think it's a slam on your attorney. His advice is advice. I have a lot of experience with this as well. You're not required to take it. It's not actionable against you if you don't take it. Ultimately, the decision is yours. Mm-hmm. When you make the decision, no matter how you decide it, you can't even blame the attorney because the decision is yours. So I encourage you.
I agree.
What's that? Yeah,
that is true.
It's absolutely yours. It's completely in your hands. So I urge you to look at the benefits versus the negatives. And the benefits are on the side of approving the application. The negatives are all on the side of denying it. Because when we get out of the other end of what could be a very long process, this is what we're going to end up with, exactly what's been proposed. I can't even see it any other way. So, all right, that's me.
Anyone else?
Yes. Good evening. My name is Sandra Fusco.
Sandra, come on down here, please. Thank you.
My name is Sandra Fusco. I'm Deputy Commissioner for the Planning, Development, and Public Transportation Department for the county. I want to make sure that everybody understands I am not in any way minimizing or disregarding anybody's concerns. Just from the procedural aspect of what the County Planning Department does, we are very well-versed in reviewing of certain things. We are charged with reviewing site plans, among other things, pursuant to the general municipal law. My understanding is, very simply, the footprint hasn't changed on this particular project. Simply, we're moving the tenancy, if you will, from one building and switching the tenancy to the other. It's not creating any regional impact that we would be concerned with. So I would respectfully disagree with the position that a new parking table needs to be submitted. Calculations are based on square footage. Square footage hasn't changed. Why then would a new parking table be required? We believe the county has a vested interest in this project. The need exists, as Director Sheehy has pointed out. As the other members of the public have pointed out, it's something that's very near and dear to everyone's hearts to have the senior center. There are some reasons why the need to change from one building to the other. That's been explained to the members of the board and the public. And again, there's nothing that the county could do to make the process any different. We follow the letter of the law. We follow the general municipal law, and we do our reviews as we're required to do. As in the words of a former professor of mine, that ship has sailed. So we believe that this project should continue to completion.
Thank you. Anyone else?
How you doing? My name is Craig Waters. I live in Phillipstown. I'd just like to comment that it's interesting how this process continues to be delayed. Clearly this has, over a significant amount of time, has really turned into, has really won the trust of the community, it's won the trust of the county, and since government is supposed to, as you yourself just said a few minutes ago, you can't do what you want, you got to do what your constituents want. I'm at a loss, and I think most of our community is, to identify who is this overwhelming majority.
To be clear, I'm speaking about my role on the village board. We don't have that latitude here. We apply the code. That's all we do here. But go ahead, please.
But as an appointed representative of our municipal government, and to be clear, I live in Phillipstown, not in the village, but obviously this village is the center and heartbeat of our town and our community, so it matters a lot to all of us. Good government comes from balanced representation, and I think a lot of us are curious, who is this majority of folks that are opposition? We have tremendous amount. This is a non...
There are no votes being taken. I'm not sure what you're...
We just got an application.
Until your recent appointment, with this project was a done deal. And then, with your recent appointment to your position, all of a sudden we have new opposition, new obstruction.
The done deal was the existing approvals, and that's still done. And that ship has sailed.
Just to be clear, so you understand, the reason why they're here is because they're making some changes to a previously approved site plan. It's not that the planning board dragged them here. They have jurisdiction over the changes and the impacts resulting from the change of uses or switches of uses, whatever you want to call it. They're not challenging the prior approvals. They're not against the prior approvals. They're just analyzing the application that's before them and the impacts of those potential changes or switches of uses.
Correct. And I feel that have been adequately addressed by our our local residents that has done a fantastic job in the community on multiple levels. I would just encourage you. I can appreciate and respect the fact that the due process. No problem with that. I don't think anyone does. But I think it's clear that our community stands behind this project, and this is the small change of use thing really is impactful. I know it's been clear that there are positives here, and I would encourage the board to approve and move forward.
Thank you. Anyone else?
When I heard
about... Your name, please?
I'm sorry, Carrie Elias is my name. So when I heard about what was going on here, I felt obligated to be here today. I've cooked for the seniors in the past, and I feel that this is definitely something that needs to be addressed in a timely fashion. It seems that what I'm looking at seems to be a safer route for the bus. We had the gentleman there talking about a bus backing into a one-way street or path. That to me seems unsafe. And you were worried about pedestrian safety. The lives of so many will be affected by your decision. I'm asking you to please consider this in a timely way. As time goes by, money is being spent. Many people are devoted hours and, just resources. We have to do this for our community. The seniors are so important to us, just as the kids are. One day, maybe one of you there will be at the senior center. Think about that. Maybe you're going to use it one day. Think about the future. Let's not think about today. Let's think about the future of the community, please.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Hi, Dave Moran, I'm the mayor of Cold Spring. I was on the town board for 3 years. I was on the Haldane School Board.
I'm sorry, can I ask you, are you speaking as mayor or speaking as an individual?
I'm speaking as an individual, okay. But since Thank others you. Have stated their qualifications to speak, I would also like to. I was on the school board for 10 years, five of which I was president. I think I know our community. What I just want to point out is that this board is not, and nor is Matt, delaying this project. If you go up on the fences right on Chestnut Street, there's a banner that says open 2016. Well, that's not happening. I'm in construction also. So there is a delay, and I would ask Mr. Galaro why the delay is and why this, the announcement of this all being done in 2016 isn't happening. Because this is the main point, this is why we're here, is because this is a delay. We got to get this done. And there's no one saying anything about the seniors. There's no one against the seniors. My mom's turning 89 tomorrow, and she gets around well, and I love her, and I love a lot of the seniors in this village and know a lot of them. I used to go down to the Phillips Town, and I would also serve the seniors when we had the dinners or the luncheons there. And I think it's great. And I think the Senior Center is fine, and I think it's going in, and I think all the approvals were made. The county, everything was represented that senior center was not going into the Leahy Pavilion. The Leahy Pavilion was going to stay as medical. It was not part of this plan. It was not looked at. If you're talking about the future, as this woman had just stated, and we're looking for the future, that's exactly what we're doing. We're looking at the future and what's going to happen or what could happen up there, and it's the responsibility of this board to take a closer look if this switch happens. Of course, Mr. Barshaw's being paid. He's very theatrical. I would love to have him on my team. But that doesn't mean he's right. It doesn't mean that what he is saying is gospel. He works for Mr. Galaro, who's the developer who wants to have this done. So obviously he's going to say this is not right and disagree with with our attorney, the attorney for the village. If the senior center was going to be on track as it would have been built already. If you wanted a senior center when this whole thing started, there were other places that it could have been, which many of the seniors wanted, which that didn't work out. But what was happening was that the senior center was used to promote and push this project through. And now we're at a place where it's all approved, it can be built out, and for the county to say, who has promised, and Mrs. Scuchamar has represented all along for years, not just this year, that the county was in on this, that we were going to get this done, and we were going to have this senior center, that was all based on a plan. And the plan was to have it in number two. And now, at the last moment, we're switching it, and now all of a sudden it becomes this planning board's problem. We're the ones that are delaying it. This board is not delaying it. They're doing what they were hired or that volunteered to do, and they represent the village. That's the difference here. This board represents the village, and they're looking at the village and what some of the repercussions of this switch can be. So if the application wants to be placed, then their responsibility is to look at it, look at the code, and say yes or no, or ask them for requirements. They're not stopping this project. This project could have been built by now. Why it hasn't, I don't know. But there's one building going up there that hardly anybody was working on all winter. And that's fine with me, but it's not the delay of the planning board that did this. It's the contractors, it's whoever. It's the developer. Why isn't it built? Why isn't it all done? Why wasn't it built as it was supposed to be? And why aren't the seniors in there? That's not the planning board's fault. The planning board is, they're looking at an application right now. So for all the county people and everyone to come over here and try to bully us into making a move that because they think it's minor, it's not good, it's not right. This planning board's doing their job. Mr. Waters wants to bring up obstruction because that's what the Putnam County News and people want to make of Matt. He's an obstructionist. He's against this. He has never once said he's against this project. Never once. But you want to bring it up because everyone wants to have that feeling that they're stopping progress here. And they're not stopping progress here. The developer's stopping progress here because his approval's all here. You could be in tomorrow if it was built the way it should have been. Thank you.
Thanks. I mean, look, I've got a very thick skin. I don't care how much of the narrative gets pointed at me. My concern with that is just that people are following a story that isn't real, right? I mean, I'm one vote on a five-person board. I was on the village board too. I mean, you can't, there's a democratic process here that has to happen. That's why there's an unequal number of us, because things go to vote and we, I would caution, the room, the press to, this narrative may be interesting that I'm an obstructionist and
it's
it may
boring.
Help. I find it boring too, but it's fine, whatever. But my concern, like I said, is just that it creates a story that really keeps you from looking at the facts, right? And it's a winning strategy. It's a very effective strategy to focus on something else as opposed to questions, as opposed to issues, as opposed to, whether or not this is something I want or this is the direction of our village council. We will certainly meet with the village attorney and he'll advise the board. And they'll, they've seen his memo. We have a 9-page memo that's the work of, it is confidential, don't try to foil it. It's the work of the village attorney telling us in his assessment with the building inspector, not the planning board, what they believe the law says and what they believe the path forward is. So if I will tell you, I will show my cards. I don't go against the village attorney, right? I don't care whether it's actionable, not actionable. The village attorney sets the path, and that's your horse, right? You can change horses, but I'm not going to go with no horse, right? John, John has given us his opinion, and that's really the way we're going to proceed. So the
and
village
I take no offense if you don't listen to my advice, because it's happened before, and I'm sure.
Oh, absolutely, but we do so at our own risk. I will tell you, I don't take that risk. I'm risk averse. Everybody knows me as risk averse. That made great copy as well. So use it, right? I calculate risk very carefully, and there has to be a risk to benefit ratio. And we don't have a whole lot of latitude in the village board. We had legislative power. This is not. We don't have legislative power. We are a board that just sits here and applies the code. When there's a question, we go to the village attorney. This also includes code enforcement that said, here's what you've got, here's your way forward. I get that many people, most of you here that spoke tonight, would like us to go against that, and you find that to be bad advice, even in complete error, according to Mr. Barshoff. So we'll take that under advisement, we'll meet with the village attorney. I guess the question, I don't know if you want to answer tonight, as to whether or not you want to proceed down this path.
What is the path that you are advocating?
The only path, the application.
Here's what I think should happen, quite simply. And here's the reason why everybody has stood up and talked about it. If you want to talk about site circulation, how the pedestrians go through, the vehicles, fine, no problem. We'll sit down, let's appoint a small committee, get the building inspector, however you want to do it. We'll sit down, it can be worked out in a week. It is the parking that has everyone here exercise. It is that which is going to be delaying things, turning around and reopening that and relooking at all of that. That is what has people upset. That is why you hear this. Everybody understands, and I'm sorry, I disagree with the mayor, whether theatrical or not. People make changes to applications all the time.
Fine, yeah.
Okay? There's engineering that goes on. People decide that there's a better way. Okay, so they decide their better way. shoot them if you don't like them, that they came up with a better way. I'm sorry. They did, and this is what they feel is best, okay? Great. I'm not second-guessing it. I don't think anybody else here should. If they did, nothing would ever change, and I don't think that that's what anybody would want. All we're saying is, very simply, please don't go down the path of looking to increase the parking. And don't tell me, please, that you're just going through some process for the sake of going through a process, because I know you're not going to decrease it, and if you leave it the same, then we're fine. So what is the only thing that you could possibly be doing if you're looking at parking, and that is to increase it? That's the only thing, and there is no basis for that. So please, talk amongst yourselves, go into executive session if you want to now, please go into and make a decision as a board that this is not what you want to do. You've heard all of these people say there's no reason to do it. Common sense tells you there's no reason to do it. There is a reason to turn around and look at the site and make sure it works properly, and no one has any issues with that. And we can resolve those issues in a week, and we can turn around and vote this at your next meeting. That is the process that I would really like to see followed.
Thank you. I have a question. If I'm hearing right, what you're saying is that the applicant made a mistake when he presented the site plan as it currently was approved. Is that correct?
No. There is no mistake. What there is, Arnie, is a very simple thing. Tenants have come to the applicant and said, we think that there is a better way for us to do what we want, what we're going to do on this site.
But isn't that a mistake?
No, absolutely not.
This concept of the bus delivery is obviously an error.
I am not going to have a philosophical discussion with you about whether you want to characterize it as a mistake. I'm turning around and saying what these people have said, and it's what makes sense. They looked at it, and they saw that there was a better way. Would the seniors have died if they would have used the other one? No. I don't think it was a mistake. I think they turned around and looked at it and said, you know what? This makes more sense. Yeah. Okay, now what do you want to do? You want to turn around and penalize them for saying it makes more sense? You want to turn around and vilify the people that are at the county who decided to look at it, and now you want to castigate them for turning around and saying that they think that there's a better way? That's what I'm hearing. I think it's ludicrous.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. All I'm saying is I don't even care about all of that, because none of that is before this board. What is before the board, and again, I'm coming back because you said it right, is whether or not the flip of these uses has some impact on the way that the site works with circulation, ingress, and egress. That is the only issue before this board. Parking should not be an issue. There is no change in the use of the medical office. That's the only thing that you have been, that you can possibly focus on. It's the only thing your council focused on, and it makes absolutely no sense. And to turn around, and I'm sorry, but this is what it is, to hide behind the opinion of council, which I'm sorry, is just, look, I have been told when I have received legal analysis that I'm wrong, and if I get that analysis and I realize I'm wrong, I'll admit that I'm wrong. That has happened in the past. It's happened more than once. So far, I saw what was written. I haven't seen the memo, so I can't comment on it. You want to share it? I'll be happy to comment on it and rebut it, okay? Because as far as I'm concerned, this isn't even a close call. You don't even have to be a lawyer. And you turn around and please, just get off that point. Do what needs to be done to address the real issues that are before the board. Let's put those to bed. Let's make sure that the site is safe. Let's make sure it works for circulation. And let's get the thing built before the winter delays things for another year. That's the delay. That's the issue. It's clean. It's simple. It's easy. And nobody is asking you to violate anything. And you're not going to violate anything, your oath of office, the codes, or anything by doing what I have suggested. Zero violation.
Thank you. I think we're done. Do you want to, any closing remarks from your position?
Nope. If you want to have a closed session,
I feel like we can
available.
Okay.
Let me, I'll spell my name for you. A-I-R, I-N-H-O-S. Last name is S-E-R-R, A-D-A-S. And since everybody's showing who they have and what they are, I was a former village trustee for 2 years, Hatley Nautic Committee, chair for two, member for six, the other additional six. I've coached at Haldane. What else have I done? Plenty of things with the community. The community to me is always first and last. That's it. Do I think there's obstructionism? Absolutely. Do I think that some of you hate seniors? Quite possibly. Can I speak?
Sure. Thank you. Hate seems to be popular this year. Go on.
Is it popular? Good.
Yes.
Then at least you guys were listening. It's a start. Let me take another step. You made a great point. Backing that, some of you were saying, bringing that bus in, well, you can't turn it around. It's very difficult to turn a car around.
It's a question. We don't need to go into the details of, you know.
I'm commenting. Let me comment and you can say whatever you want afterward. Shifting the buildings, you're not shifting the buildings. All you should be doing is shifting the use. My personal experience, to get my uncle into my car takes me 15 minutes. To get my mother-in-law, my father-in-law into the car takes me 30. If either of you ever understood that or saw that, you get a glimpse of what these folks are talking about.
You don't think any of us have parents? Go ahead.
Are you going to keep interrupting, Matt?
I think it's offensive, but go ahead.
I'm sorry.
Okay,
I'm very hurt by those statements you were making. When you're addressing the planning board, you're addressing all of us, and we all care very much. And it's really not right to come and make insinuations about our personal opinions. So please, try to respect us. We respect you.
This process has been going on for 5 years or better. It happened, it came up before I was elected. It was one of the things I've addressed. Whether you say you're for it, Matt, or not, you're on record many times against it. And there are...
No.
Yes,
PCNR.
You are.
No. PCNR is not the record.
Better Butterfield.
Oh, Facebook post? Great, that's the PCNR too.
But you posted. You posted that.
What?
Anyway, we're getting off topic.
We are off topic. It's not
the
relevant.
The point I'm making is quite simple. The developer, county, recognized that there is an issue, and the best way to solve that issue is to have everyone on the ground floor. Beyond that, it's irrelevant.
Of only one building, to be clear. There are three buildings.
I'm only talking about the ones we're talking about.
Understood.
Okay. I've never understood, ever, why so many people have been stalling this. Okay. There are more people that are for this than are against it. Yeah. And I think that a lot of you represent a majority of the minority, not the majority. I do have a couple questions for you. I wrote them down so I wouldn't confuse them. Did the approved site plan include 35 spaces for medical office use? Is that yes or no?
It's a public comment session.
I'm just asking a question. Does the modified site plan submitted by the owner include 35 spaces for medical use for offices? It's been discussed a number of times. It's always said...
We don't have a modified site plan. Are you talking about the application?
Just go to the question, medical office use. Do we have 35 spaces that are allocated?
The approving planning board approved 35 spaces for medical use at the existing Leahy Pavilion.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And that includes the medical office, correct?
The medical pavilion, yes.
Okay. Quite honestly, just stop the delays. I mean, a lot of this is pettiness, and we need to get on with it.
Sir, we just received the application.
No. I have the floor now. This is embarrassing for this community.
We just received an application.
Right.
How many times do we need to say that? We have not held it up. There was an approved application. They came back for modification. They submitted another application. We are reviewing this application. I am doing my job as a volunteer. We are not delaying it.
How long did it take to put up the towers? Because we're pretty much getting close to that time. We're putting up these buildings. Towers of Manhattan.
The developer owns the construction schedule.
How long did it take to put those in?
But I'm not Silverstein. I don't know.
That's right. You're not Silverstein. The point is, if this keeps going, it's going to be like that. And I personally am tired of losing all that revenue. Everybody who's been there 15, 20 years has at least paid $250,000 in school tax. Then another $75,000 to $100,000 in regular tax. Those buildings, zero impact to the community in terms of cost. We reap a tremendous amount of benefit that this stalling process is losing. The village needs money. We know they do. So you're costing everybody money. And it's become your personal issue with every resident. Thank you.
I'm not sure where you believe the village, you know, gains and where the tax base goes down, but I mean, you know, the planning board is not stalling anything. We're going to process an application. We'll meet afterwards. We'll work on the application.
It's not that the tax base goes down, Matt.
Thank you.
We don't receive it.
Hi, I'm Shirley Norton. I live in senior housing, Chestnut Ridge Senior Housing in Cold Spring, and I just wanted to thank all of the county people that came tonight and spoke and, you know, tried to clarify things. And I agreed with John, you know, there, everybody I've been angry with and upset with, you know, all these four years. And, you know, that's okay, you know. I mean, but here we are, and just asking you to, I mean, you have the application. It's been explained everything, so would you please, you know, we're ready to go. So I appreciate you, too. I appreciate the village board. I appreciate all of you because, you know, somehow you're all part of the whole thing. And we just, as you said, we just want to take care of the seniors. We want that to happen. And it, to me, it was explained, this whole thing tonight was explained really well. And, you know, I appreciate you, and I hope you'll, you know, vote and we'll get moving again. So thank you.
All right, thank you. Is that it?
That's it.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Shirley. Do we want to make a motion to go into it would be advice of council, it's not executive session.
Right.
Do we have a motion to go into without air conditioning? I'm not sure how much more I can take, but let's give it a try. Do we have a motion to go into advice of council?
We go into advice.
Do we have a second?
Second motion.
So moved, we'll go into an advice of council session. We could probably go in the small room.
Now the public meeting is closed, correct?
I think actually, yeah, you know, you're right.
We're not going to.
Let's close the public
back.
Meeting. Close the meeting, public meeting first.
Yes.
All right. So, do I have a motion to close the meeting? Do I have a second?
Second.
So moved. The meeting is closed. Thank you all so much.
Thanks, everyone. We really appreciate it.
Matt, so there'll be no public session after your.
We won't reopen. No. How you doing, John?
How are you?
Better for like, is it 100 degrees in here, or is it just
me? I know this is a tough job.
You know, you do have to take the heat.
That's pretty much fire.
Good. Nice to be at the peace environment.